Melanie is a member of the advisors for our TCORS, and for the last couple of days provided us great advice. And now she's going to tell you about what is, I think, a really important next step in tobacco control for all of us. So welcome, Melanie. Thanks for being here.
Okay. So John has to go somewhere else, but he'll be back. So.
I'll be back soon.
So thanks very much for the opportunity to speak today. It's been great to spend a little time here and hear about the TCORS and how that's developing. And I've also had a couple of days where I've managed to get around Los Angeles a bit and explore Pasadena in particular. So that's been fun. So I've got quite a few slides, and I'm going to just plunge straight in and get into it. So today I'm going to talk about what is plain packaging, give you a good graphic description of what it constitutes, and a little bit of introduction about how we came to get plain packaging, to talk about how the tobacco industry responded, also to talk about some research that we've been doing that has debunked some of the industry claims about how the sky would fall in when plain packaging happened. Talk about some early effects of the legislation on consumers and give you an idea of what else is in the pipeline. And then really just make a comment about how we're planning to assess some of the effects of plain packaging and so forth. So this is what plain packs are designed to look like now in Australia. So basically the legislation prohibits the use of colours and most of the branding elements, including design and so forth. You can't have any textural colour sort of aspects of packaging. You can't have any sounds when the pack opens and so forth. The dark olive brown colour was chosen after a lot of research that was done to kind of work out which would be the least appealing pack colour. And also the brand and the brand variant name is standardised in a particular font, which is one of the most readable fonts, has to be a particular size. The brand name is in a larger font than the brand variant name. So this is what your pack of Marlboro used to look like in Australia and what it looks like now. So it's a very different it evokes very different emotions when you look at it. And Winfield on the left is our most popular brand in Australia, sold in a pack of 25, and the difference is very stark there. At the same time that plain packaging was introduced, we also had larger graphic health warnings, and so they cover 75% of the front of the pack with a large graphic image and the main sort of takeout message of the health warning. And then on the back of the pack is a lot more detailed information about the why that's a health harm of smoking and the number of the quit line that people can go to get advice and information for quitting. The health warnings came in two rounds of seven. So when plain packaging came in, set A warnings came in, all seven of them. And a year later, set B warnings came in. And so the idea is to really keep refreshing the health warnings on those packs so they tend not to wear out so quickly.
I'm sorry, could you see how many there are altogether?
There's 14 warnings.
14.
Two sets of seven.
And you're going to introduce more every year?
There is the capacity to do that in the future, but it's not in the legislation at the moment, it's in the regulation. So plainness also applies to the cigarette sticks. So sticks are either required to be like a cork tip filter type of look, or a white sort of stick. They can't be coloured, they can't have any branding information on the stick, they can't have a little gold band that a lot of them have. There can be an alphanumeric code around the tube, and that's really just for recall purposes if there was some terrible, you know, additional poison that was found in a particular batch of cigarettes, they'd be able to recall that. It also applies to roll-your-own tobacco. This is what a pouch of roll-your-own tobacco looks like, and a tin of cigarillos and small cigars. Single cigars now look like this, and this is a bag. If you buy multiple cigars, it needs to be sold in that. So cigars are no longer branded with the classic branding around the cigar, it's much more standardised. And that's important to that plain packaging applied to the whole range of tobacco products, not just cigarettes. So this is the then Prime Minister and the then Health Minister, Nicola Roxon, who really, I think, had a genuine commitment to prevention. And very much, Nicola very much had a commitment to tobacco control and wanted to do something big in prevention. And she thought that doing something big in tobacco would be the best bang for the buck, and plain packaging would be the best thing that she could do. So plain packaging was recommended as part of the Australian Preventative Health Task Force in 2009. And the government announced that they would be going with plain packaging in April 2010. And that is consistent with the FCTC Article 13 guidelines. It was also announced with a 25% increase in the tax on tobacco, and that's quite important. It's done as part of a suite of tobacco control measures. Australia has mass media campaigns as well, so there's quite a lot of interventions going on. Plain packaging is not something that you expect to be a magic bullet and change everything. It's part of a comprehensive tobacco control strategy. So there, I won't go through the details of all the back and forth with the politics of it, but ultimately the opposition supported the legislation and the minor parties, and it went through. There are three objectives of plain packaging. Firstly, to reduce the appeal of tobacco products to consumers, and that's especially applies to young people. And so there are lots of examples of different packaging designed to appeal to particular subgroups of the population, and you undoubtedly can identify which subgroups some of your brands are most likely to be designed to appeal to. Secondly, to increase the effectiveness of health warnings on the retail packaging of tobacco products. These are the types of warnings we had in the 6 years before plain packaging, 30% graphic health warnings, and you can see that, you know, increasingly even then the designers of the packs are integrating them into the look of the packs and the colours and so forth. So with plain packaging, the warning is really designed to stand out. And thirdly, the objective here is to reduce the ability of the packaging to mislead consumers about the harms of smoking. And this is just an example of the range of products in our most commonly smoked brand, and how colour has been used to kind of signify the level of strength in the different brand variants, and that's no longer the case. They all look the same. So I mentioned that the announcement of the legislation occurred in April 2010, and later that year the government formed an expert advisory group made up of lawyers and scientists, marketing people, and I was on that committee and took the lead on designing a series of studies to work out what should be the plain pack colour, what should it look like, how should the health warnings be integrated. And so we undertook about seven studies in a very short space of time in late 2010, early 2011, to try and work out what is the least appealing colour, what is the colour that most puts smokers off. And we used a series of best-worst studies where people could kind of rate which was the least and most appealing pack from a whole range of different colours. And I won't go through the individual studies, but also looking at how to actually integrate the health warnings, the different kind of options there from the existing kind of health warning size that we had to 50%, 75%, and a split health warning, which the retail associations, which were a front group for the industry, thought would be the best one. And in fact, that was no more effective than this one, so that told you something. In the end, we went with the 75% warning. So that's kind of how a quick overview of what the legislation looks like. How the industry responded. First of all, I suppose that there are two sides to that. There are ways in which the industry responded in terms of what they did to kind of try and compensate for plain packaging in terms of some of their marketing, and then secondly, some of the ridiculous consequences they said would happen as a result of plain packaging. First of all, the marketing response, and you might have seen this, this little cartoon before, these new regulations will fundamentally change the way we get around them, which I think really encapsulates what the industry has tried to do here. This paper is about to come out in tobacco control, and really it's a sort of documentation of the different strategies the industry has used to try and compensate for plain packaging. It will be online shortly. I mentioned that plain packaging was announced in April 2010. The legislation was finally passed in November 2011. And then from the 1st of October 2012, only plain packs could be manufactured. And from the 1st of December 2012, only plain packs could be sold at retail. So we expected some of the plain packs to start coming onto the market after the 1st of October, and gradually from the 1st of December, everything that was sold had to be plain. So the period that we looked at was really the period after plain packaging was announced right through to plain packaging became implemented in the field. So we monitored a whole lot of different sources, and we found five major trends. We used trade magazines, we looked at promotional flyers that were designed for retailers. We also took account of some of the incidental reports from public health workers that were out in the field, and they kind of sent things in and said, hey, look at this. We also did checking of online prices and products in supermarkets and various kind of large-scale retailers, and visits to bricks and mortar retail stores. This is an example of something that came out from British American Tobacco, which says the pack is changing but the product remains the same. And it's basically sort of saying that, you know, this is some of the brand variant names will be changing, and it's sort of giving instructions to the retailers, I suppose. This is a magazine called The Australian Retail Tobacconist, which lists all of the products, tobacco products available in Australia, all the brand variants and all the recommended retail prices, and that was a great source of information for us. So there are five kind of main kind of developments that we saw. We saw the launch of some new super value brands. We saw a whole lot of reassurance messages from tobacco companies, and I'll show you some examples of those. Some innovations in terms of design, and also renaming of brand variant names to kind of strengthen give more meaning to the brand variant name. We saw the emergence of packs with extra cigarettes inside as a kind of a better deal for consumers. There was quite a bit of rationalisation of the product and pack size range, so some variants came off the market, some new ones came on. And we also saw the introduction of novel menthol cigarette types as well, which also has been seen in other places as well, not necessarily just due to plain packaging. So this is an example of the super value brands that have been introduced, which really try and provide a cheaper option for consumers. In a plain packaging environment, really, it's if you're a marketer, you really are having to compete on price more than just brand, rather than just brand appeal. And Bond Street is from Philip Morris, and a brand called Just Smokes is from British American Tobacco, which has the largest market share in Australia. And it's a pretty ordinary brand name, and it's sort of unusual they would introduce a whole new brand out of the blue. But it's a deep discount brand, and pretty plain in and of itself. Here's an example of messages sent by some of the companies pasted on the brands to reassure consumers. This one here says, new laws mean your pack will soon change. The taste, however, remains the same. And of course, we know in the marketing literature that pack
packaging can really lead consumers to think that products are going to taste a certain way, and when you change the packaging, people can really experience or taste the products quite differently, even though they're exactly the same. And companies know this happens, so they went out of their way to try and reassure everyone that we aren't changing the product, it's just the packaging. And it was interesting in terms of consumers. Some consumers kind of were absolutely convinced that the companies had changed the product because it tasted so different, whereas others just completely accepted, oh, it's just packaging, you know, it's fine, I'll get used to it. And I would suspect many of them have. This is a Imperial Tobacco with the Peter Stuyvesant brand. They actually brought out some packs before plain packaging was designed to required to come out, to kind of slightly change the look of their packs. And so this one was kind of half and half. So they were really trying to sort of reassure consumers that the same product was in these very unappealing looking packs. There's some more examples. We saw for some brands in the last sort of 6 months to a year of when branded packaging was able to be used, quite a lot of experimentation with the different types of packs. And I think they really were just trying to emphasise the feel of the brand, have a one go out in one last great blast before everything had to become the same. So there was, you know, quite a lot of different positioning of the brand name and various sort of evocative tones used with colour and so forth. Also, some of the brand variant names on the plain packs were extended to use to include the colour of the old branded packs. So here you can see that choice here in a blue pack became choice, not just choice blue, but choice original blue. And Peter Jackson Rich became Peter Jackson Rich Gold. So not just replaced with the word of the colour, but also a much more descriptive and evocative set of adjectives. So that was interesting. Here's another one, Pall Mall Amber became Pall Mall Smooth Amber, and so forth. We also saw the introduction of some products. So that was, you know, quite a lot of a long kind of longer name, which took up more of the pack, and there was no limit on how long those names could be. So this is Marlborough Red, and Philip Morris actually re-registered their brand name from Marlborough to Marlborough Red, so that the red could be in the large font of the brand name instead of the, whereas usually the red should be a brand variant in a smaller font. So they really tried everything. This is another example. This is a price board. This is an example. Marlborough Silver Fine Scent is a, you know, sounds like a perfume. it's a tobacco product. So we're seeing here gradually, because all tobacco products, the display of tobacco products is banned at the point of sale. So really when you walk into a convenience store, all you see is the price board. And they are using price boards for promotion. So there's a much greater likelihood of premium products being at the top of the board, because that's where the eye naturally travels to start scanning. The companies make a lot more profit off premium brands, so they want you to switch to premium. But we'd like to get rid of these price boards as well. This is another development. We saw the development of new pack sizes. In Australia, we have packs between 20 and 50, and they're usually 20, 25, 30, 40, and 50. As the price is going up and the tax is going up, packs of 50, the upfront purchase price is just way too high. So a pack of 25 is well over $20 for consumers to buy a pack of 50. You can imagine how expensive that would be. So we think they're going to gradually come off the market. But there was nothing stopping companies from adding one or two extra cigarettes and charging the same price, so consumers would feel they were getting a couple of cigarettes for free as this happened. This is just another example of some different pack sizes of 21, 26 and so forth. I mentioned we saw some new products and brand sizes or brand variants introduced and also dropped as well from as they're kind of rationalising where to put their effort in terms of their brand portfolio. Finally, we saw the introduction of some of these menthol kind of variants. This one actually isn't menthol, it's a tobacco mint fusion cigarette with sort of mint leaves in it as well, which is just a sort of novelty product and marketed as a premium menthol product. We saw quite a lot of, this is before the plain packaging came in, more graded levels of menthol, so you can have sea green, cool blast, cool chill, so more and more menthol depending, you can kind of dial it up depending on what you would like. We also saw the introduction of menthol hybrid cigarettes, which are little squeezy beads that are in the cigarettes, and you can squeeze them and release a bit of menthol. These ones are called Peter Jackson Hybrid, and it was interesting that after plain packaging was introduced, this is what they looked like, and then maybe it was probably about a year or so afterwards, they tried to educate consumers about how to actually use these. It's kind of hybrids for dummies. And now it's Peter Jackson Hybrid Blue Regular to Fresh, you know, so the idea is you've got to squeeze this bead. They're trying to, you know, emphasise the fact that there is this bead in the cigarette. So they try to use quite a lot of different strategies to kind of compete in quite a darkly regulated market for them. I don't think we've ever seen such a crescendo of different strategies happening at the same time. And we think that this really has some lessons for other countries who are interested to pursue similar legislation, that we think, you might have some limitations on brand, the length of the brand variant names or something like that. You might have limitations on the pack sizes and so forth. So we think that our legislation is not perfect, and the next country that does it should be able to make some improvements. Another way that the industry responded was to make a whole lot of predictions about what they thought would happen when plain packaging came in, and there was this huge kind of like, oh my God, it's such a nanny state, we shouldn't have this kind of legislation. And the industry, through the retailers, ended up having these life-size statues in cardboard of a kind of Gestapo-type nanny, standing there telling you what to do. And, all this stuff about, this is going to lead to a whole lot of illicit cigarettes, there'll be a lot more crime, they even linked it to terrorism and stuff like that. It was ridiculous. There were also a whole lot of objections in terms of the legality of it, and particularly in terms of international trade. And at the moment, there are two pieces of litigation going on at the international level. One is through the World Trade Organization, and the other is through a bilateral investment treaty between Hong Kong and Australia. I won't talk a lot about those, but there was also within Australia the idea that plain packaging was an abuse of the company's trademarks, and so the companies took us to the High Court, took the government to the High Court, and the government won 6-1 in the High Court. And that was because we aren't actually using the company's trademarks, we're simply restricting the use of their trademarks. And that's, you're able to do that if there's a public health requirement. This is the Hong Kong-Australia Bilateral Investment Treaty. And we think the chances of them winning this are about as bleak as the scene depicted in this photograph, because I mentioned that the government made the announcement that we would be going with plain packaging in April 2010. But then in February, 9 months later, the company moved itself from Australia to Hong Kong, and then it lodged this objection that there was a trade restriction because they're now based in Hong Kong. And the trouble is they did this after they knew plain packaging would be introduced. So we think that they had fair warning, and we don't have a case to answer. Nonetheless, they're still pursuing it, and it's taking a lot of resources at the government level to fight this. Another set of objections related to it's going to be so difficult for retailers to work out which brand is which at the point of sale to be able to serve consumers in a timely way. And particularly for small retail outlets, which are supposed to be convenience stores, we're going to end up with these long lines of people who are waiting to get served, and they're going to give up and eventually go to a large tobacconist or supermarket, and these poor retail convenience outlets are going to go down the tube, So we thought there was quite a lot we could do to try and test that claim, because retailers aren't stupid, and we thought we could objectively test that. So I'll show you a study that aimed to do that. A whole other set of objections has been that it will make cigarettes easier to counterfeit and packs easier to counterfeit. The reality is that cigarette packaging is easy to counterfeit anyway. Plain packaging doesn't make it any easier. The idea that that the companies kind of put out was that there would be a lot of illicit tobacco and it would increase illicit trade and so forth. And just like in every other country of the world, the tobacco industry invests a lot in drumming up concern about this, and yet the best evidence that we can all produce is a fairly low level of illicit tobacco use in Australia, not least of which because we're a huge island in the middle of nowhere and it's quite difficult to get stuff into Australia. So these are the main industry claims: that the policy would be ineffective, it would increase retailer serving time, resulting in loss of convenience and shift of trade to supermarkets. It would lead to a dramatic drop in prices, and that would trigger an increase in consumption. It would cost the government billions in compensation and result in dramatic increases in the use of illicit tobacco. So what we have tried to do is to look at some of these claims and put them to the test. And in one of a series of studies that we've done, has involved looking at a national panel of tobacco retail outlets, where we've looked at tobacco pack retrieval time, how long it's taken retailers to retrieve packs when consumers have asked for them, before and after plain packaging, looking at retailers' preparedness to sell illicit tobacco. So we have a protocol where we go into stores and have a go at trying to buy that. We've got a study underway looking at the prices of the most prominently promoted brands, so we can see what's happening to pricing, and a whole series of other studies as well. This is a study that was published in Tobacco Control early last year, and we have an update which is under review at the moment. And this is really looking at the issue of, are there longer retail transaction times when you go to buy a pack of cigarettes? We had a panel of 400 retailers overall, but we had a subsample of 300 that we established in May 2012 in four capital cities in Australia, stratified by socioeconomic status. And we had trained field workers who went in, and we had a kind of a cluster sampling procedure. So we had milk bars and delis, which are like your mom and pop stores, convenience stores, petrol outlets, petrol stations, and newsagents and lottery outlets were a combined category. A kind of good distribution of stores in different areas and so forth. We had six occasions where we went back to those same stores to complete field work, two visits before plain packaging, one visit just in the first 2 weeks of plain packaging, and then three visits in the subsequent months. The field workers entered the store and asked the retailer for a particular pack of cigarettes, and then they unobtrusively recorded the time from when they finished asking for when the retailer either scanned the product or put the product down on the counter. And they also noted any delays or interruptions where the requested pack was not in stock. And there were things like, sometimes the door of the retail display got stuck, or the retailer got interrupted in the middle of serving them through some completely irrelevant matter. I'll just quickly go through for the sake of getting to time, that basically this was the retrieval duration here, and you can see there's a bit of a blip going up in December, but the companies thought that the retail retrieval time would increase by 15 to 45 seconds, and so the best we could try and get was about a couple of seconds. And when you kind of added in, did a bit of a sensitivity analysis and added in all of the kind of things that interrupted retailers and so forth, everything went up, but obviously it still was hardly a blip there. And most of that blip was due to the first week of the data collection, where retailers were still just getting used to it, and lo and behold, they very quickly did get used to it, and it's pretty much come down to be as low, if not lower, than it was before. So we think we've knocked that one on the head. I won't go through the strengths and limitations just for the sake of time. The next study from this set of retailers that we've looked at has just gone online in tobacco control, and this is a study designed to look at retailers' willingness to sell illicit tobacco before and after plain packaging. In Australia, there are two types of illicit tobacco. One is unbranded tobacco, which is known in Australia as chop chop tobacco. And it's sold in plastic bags as loose tobacco or pre-rolled into cigarettes, so you can buy a plastic bag of it. The other type of illicit tobacco is branded manufactured tobacco products, which are cigarette packs. And these are where the excise duty hasn't been paid, so they could be very cheap. They may or may not be counterfeit. And also there's a category of these called cheap whites or illicit whites, which are legally manufactured in a different country, but they're made for the illicit market and exported overseas. And they're made to look a bit like some of the major name brands. So in Australia, as I mentioned, there are very alarming kind of reports about how frequent some of these products are in the market. Up to 14% of the market, they think, is illicit tobacco. And I can tell you that our best estimates put it somewhere at around about 2%, maybe 3%. It's very much smaller. So we thought, well, we'll have a look and see how easy it might be or hard it might be to locate where illicit tobacco could be sold. And we wanted to do that from the point of view of the average consumer. So we particularly were interested to look at how willing retailers might be to sell unbranded chop-chop tobacco, and also products that could be contraband. And we defined those as where they didn't bear Australian health warnings, or they cost less than 20% of the recommended retail price, which is pretty cheap in Australia. So again, we had a mixture of these stores. I won't go through that. So for our irregular branded cigarette sub-study, we had 303 because we actually physically bought a pack of cigarettes and could examine it. The unbranded Chop Chop study, we had 179 stores. We did not include supermarkets in that sample. And we did not include petrol stations because they're all chain stores. And we think it's pretty unlikely that they would have ever sold those kind of products. So we really went for the small retailers where most of the tobacco companies say that these products are sold. Again, we completed fieldwork on 6 occasions, twice before, very soon after implementation, and 3 times after implementation. And fieldwork has entered the store and asked the retailer for the cheapest pack that was available to buy. And then while they actually were purchasing that pack, they kind of said to the retailer, "Hey, you know, I was wondering if you knew where I could buy any chop tobacco around here." And the retailer could respond in a number of different ways. I'll show you how. And then the packs that we purchased and took away, we later examined to see whether they had any of the met any of the criteria. In other words, whether they had any non-Australian health warnings or no health warnings, and whether their cost was extremely low. So when we ask for unbranded chop tobacco, the retailers could say, no idea, sorry. Or they could, quite frequently, they just confused it with roll your own tobacco. And if that was the case, we asked again, no, I don't mean roll your own, I mean chop tobacco, you know. And giving them the eye, you know. And vague information, they could sort of say, oh, I'm sure you can get it around here somewhere, maybe, you know, the next suburb or something like that. They could give specific information. Oh yeah, definitely, tobacconist around the corner. Good luck. Or they could directly offer to sell chop to the field worker. And then the final category we had was where retailers became suspicious of the field worker and the sale didn't go through, and we coded that as well. So most of the time when we ask this question, 70 or 80% of the retailers just had no idea. Many of them continued to confuse it with roll your own tobacco, even though we kind of said, no, I don't mean roll your own tobacco. So, you know, 80 to 90% of retailers just really weren't able to say. A small percentage became suspicious of the retailer, of the field worker, especially in December. And we think that was because there were a whole lot of inspectors going out to make sure that plain packs were being sold and replaced with branded packs. And so we think that that was just an impact of them being aware that that was going on. Depending on the month, between 5 and 9% of the time, we had a positive response. And in the positive response, we're extremely generous. We also included the vague information. But if you include specific information or the offer to sell chop tobacco, it's really infrequent that there would be anyone, run-of-the-mill smoker who would go to a retailer and be able to get chop tobacco. Then also in terms of the packs that we examined, extremely low prevalence, really less than 1%, were non-compliant with Australian health warnings or sold below the tax liability. So again, we think that plain packaging has not resulted in a flood of illicit tobacco on the market, at least from this study. Okay, so the majority of cigarettes sold in Australia are actually purchased from supermarkets, and there's just absolutely no suggestion of illicit sales from supermarkets. Tobacco companies are suggesting they aren't sold there either. So there may be illicit cigarettes being sold in Australia, but we think it's extremely rare, and we think that there may be, you know, if you knew exactly where to go, you might be able to find them. But it's not going to be a mass behaviour. The third industry concern was that prices would really go down in Australia of tobacco, and that would actually lead to people smoking more cigarettes. In Australia, the market is split into premium, mainstream and value brands, and we have a consumer price index increase in tobacco, so just keeping up with the rate of inflation on the 1st of February and the 1st of August each year. I mentioned we've got a variation of pack sizes in Australia. We don't have packs less than 20. And we've got a whole lot of different sources of information about prices, some of which we can't access, so we cannot buy the Nielsen scanner data in Australia like you can here. The industry won't let us have that. But we can look at recommended retail prices and we can do our surveys of retail outlets and so forth. So the top line kind of takeaway is that we think that it's really business as usual after plain packaging. It's as profitable after as it was before. There's some pressure happening at the value end in terms of a bit of discounting, but there's no gross across the board discounting. So prices just simply did not plummet, and that's what the industry said would happen, and it just didn't happen. There's quite a lot of jostling for position between companies. And it seems really to us that pricing and taxation is the big driver of what's going on with the industry in terms of its pricing behaviour rather than plain packaging. So that's something to look at in the longer term. Okay, now moving on to the effects of the legislation on consumers. So we've got three studies that are out in the literature. The first is a study of, was a kind of an opportunistic study, which is published in BMJ Open around the middle of last year. Every year we do an annual population survey in our state of Victoria. It happens to be in the field in November. And so if you remember that the rollout period for plain packaging was October and November of 2012, we were in the field in that time. And so what we were able to do was that some smokers were smoking from plain packs for the first time and other smokers were still smoking from the branded packs. So we were able to do a comparison of those two groups of smokers, which we did. We ended up with just over 500 cigarette smokers, 72% of whom were smoking from a plain pack. And we looked at a whole lot of different measures there. And the main, we adjusted for the differences between two of them. And among those who were smoking from plain packs compared to branded smokers, plain pack smokers perceived cigarettes to be lower in quality, less satisfying than a year ago. They were more likely to have thought about quitting once a day in the past week. They were more likely to rate quitting as a higher priority in their life. And interestingly, they were more likely to support the policy too. So, and that's a common kind of effect that, you know, once tobacco control policies come in, people get used to them and the level of support goes up. So there were some quite good encouraging findings there. Secondly, this study that we've got published in Addiction at the earlier this year was a study, an observational study, so it's not subject to self-report bias or anything like that. And this study really is based on the idea that a lot of people's ideas about brand image and so forth is really a result of their incidental exposure to branding as they're walking around in the community. And obviously people, because they retain their tobacco packs, can make a statement about themselves, and they use their tobacco packs largely in an unconscious way to do that. Often people leave their packs out when they're sitting down and having a cigarette, and it's easy for others to see what brand they're smoking. The idea of this study was really to go out and look at how frequently tobacco packs were being displayed by consumers and how they were being displayed. So were the health warnings being displayed, or were the branding side up being displayed, or were they being a little bit concealed and so forth. And we did that in outdoor cafe venues around Melbourne and Adelaide. And we chose those two capital cities because outdoor smoking bans have not come in yet. So sometimes when you lag behind, it's a good research opportunity to make most of it. So our hypotheses were that the rate of pack display and active smoking, the rate of those two things to the number of patrons would decline over time. And we defined active smoking as because it was an observational study, we had to observe someone actually smoking or getting ready to smoke or whatever. And we thought that the rate of face-up pack orientation among the packs that we did observe would actually go down. So packs would either become more likely to be slightly concealed or put face down. So I mentioned that we used Melbourne and Adelaide. We identified a whole swathe of busy cafe strips, and we went along with our iPhones and collected our data. And I did that around the corner from me in my local area every Saturday morning. And people must have thought I was just an idiot. But anyway, I did it, and so did everyone else. So we collected 9 waves of data before plain packaging, in the summer before plain packaging, and we were in the field as the plain packs rolled in, and in the early post-plain packaging period. And so for each venue, we counted the number of patrons, active smokers, the number of packs, and noted whether they were plain, branded, or unknown. And we noted the orientation of every pack, so whether it was face up, face down, on its side, and so forth, or whether it was enclosed in an external cigarette case. And then for each venue, we noted whether children were present as well. And we used a multi-level Poisson regression to look at the rates, and we adjusted for a whole lot of things. And then we looked for interactions as well, in terms of whether there were differences by city, by socioeconomic status of the area where the observations have been done, the presence of children, and so forth. So basically, cutting to the chase, we found that the rate of active smokers to patrons declined by 22%. We found that that was largely driven by the fact that, that the overall number of packs per patron declined by 15% overall. That was the big kind of picture look. But that was largely driven by the fact that the rate of active smokers to patrons declined by 22%. In other words, what that means is that the packs per smoker didn't change. So if you smoked, if you observed smoking, you still took your pack out. It's just that we observed fewer people smoking. So did we think that there had been a mass number of people quitting smoking? No, we think that was pretty unlikely. But we did think that people were less prepared to light up in a public place. So there was more stigma associated with lighting up in a public place. And that's kind of a good effect. We had some differences also over time in pack orientation. So where we did observe packs, the percentage of packs that were face up declined by about 13%. So we ended up with more packs that were concealed by a phone or a wallet on the top. That more than doubled, and the percentage of cigarettes that were enclosed in an external cigarette case also increased, but not very much. So just before plain packaging, only 1.5% of packs were enclosed like that, and afterwards it was 3.5% of packs. So that's a common kind of concern with large graphic health warnings, that people think, oh, everyone's just going to decant their cigarettes from their horrible packs into a nice, pretty, decorative cigarette case. And actually, that really doesn't happen. People don't really persist with that. We had some changes in terms of socioeconomic status as well. People were less likely to light up in high socioeconomic areas. And we found that in low socioeconomic areas, people were much more likely to put their cigarettes face down to try and avoid the health warnings, which is kind of interesting. We discussed that in the paper about why that might be. So I think overall, though, that pattern of results is quite consistent with what you would hope to see. We also found that pack display was much less likely. The effects of that associated with the plain packaging were much more likely where children were present in venues. And that's really important, because it means that, I think that's one of the most important actual outcomes of this paper, because it shows that smokers are less likely to be displaying packs, taking them out where children are present, and with the introduction of plain packaging. So children are less likely to be exposed to some of the branding that we know is available on packs, because plain packaging has come in, which is great. So there's some good implications of that. One graph on calls to the quit line, so you can see the red line there with plain packaging coming in. This is a study from New South Wales, was published in the Medical Journal of Australia. So there was an increase in calls to the quit line when plain packaging came in and the large graphic health warnings together. And compared to the 2006 introduction of just the small graphic health warnings, there was a similar kind of increase, but the plain packaging one has lasted a bit longer, which is interesting.
Is the call number on the pad? Mm-hmm.
Oh, both times, yeah, exactly. So just to finish off, so some of the studies that are underway in the field, that we're doing a couple of government evaluations. The main two are one of adult smokers and recent quitters. We have a continuous cross-sectional tracking survey, 400 a month from April 2012 to April 2014, so we've just come out of the field. And we're looking at smokers and recent quitters, that is people who've quit in the last year. So we're getting this kind of dynamic picture of what has happened over time. As plain packs have come onto the market, we're able to adjust for other tobacco control policies that have been happening over that period. We're particularly looking at people's beliefs and attitudes and experiences and reported behaviours. Each of the months of cross-section has a one-month follow-up, so we're looking at some prediction of change as well over time. So we're in the intense data analysis phase of that. We also have a study of high school students. We coordinate the National School Children Surveys for Australia. We did a survey in 2011, and so in two of the states, we've gone back in 2013 to sort of look at change over time, a year after plain packaging has come in. But the main regular surveys, we're in the field this year to do all the Australian schools, so that will have some additional data as well. Ron Borland has work from the International Tobacco Control Policy Survey that he's looking at, and Jim Thrasher has an online study which is looking at smokers in Australia and a few other countries when plain packaging and graphic health warnings have come in. Okay. This is the last slide. So the industry basically has demanded that what should happen is that we should have a sharp decline in smoking prevalence, which should become evident immediately after plain packaging has come in. And I don't know of any other tobacco control policy that actually has resulted in that, especially in adolescent smoking. We know that doesn't really happen. Most of the time, when you ever get a larger prevalence decline than most other policies, is when you have a significant tax increase. We know that branding is extremely powerful and durable. So for most adult smokers, the effects are not going to be very apparent on their behaviour, you know, a month later. You certainly might expect to detect some beliefs and attitude changes. It's very much the case that, I think the best example is my own example when I went to the Atlanta Museum of Coca-Cola, and I went into one of those rooms where you watch the reel of ads from many, many years, and I realised that all the ads from when I was 5 years old onwards, I remembered all of them, but I didn't remember them before that, and that was just stunning to me. I thought they were in my brain, and that I just didn't know that I remembered them. So I think branding is very much like that. The plain packaging part of the policy is really about influencing adolescents, that our adolescent smoking prevalence is already very low. So getting more, an accelerated rate of decline after plain packaging would be, unbelievable, really. We think that it would be likely to take about 5 years or so to become detectable in terms of behaviour, because what you're really trying to do is to look at the cohort of adolescents or young people as they age into adolescence and are diverted from taking up smoking. So you actually have to wait 5 years for that to happen. And of course, there are many other policies to take account of. So particularly with some of the evaluation we're doing at the moment, we're looking at some of the more proximal objectives rather than the behaviour outcomes in particular. We're expecting change in proximal outcomes like attitudes and beliefs rather than behavioural outcomes per se. Okay, I'll leave it at that. Thank you very much. And happy to
Maybe what we should do is for those who have questions or discussions with Melanie, come up and talk to her, and think there's opportunity to do that. I mean, this is a really important story, and the other important story, and I don't know whether you mentioned, was the Uruguay.
I did mention it, but yeah.
I mean, just the other important piece around brand is Uruguay, which has said that there can only be a single representation of a brand, which means that, for example, for Marlboro, where there's many different kinds of Marlboros, or many other brands where there are multiple products, there can only be one. So this would be another direct threat to the idea of brand, which is, you know, the industry regards as a key part of their intellectual property portfolio. Because after all, when you look at them, aren't all cigarettes are roughly the same? And I think so this is really important for all of us.